So, بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم وبه نستعين والعاقبة للمتقين ولا عدوان إلا على الظالمين نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم تسليما كثيرا. Welcome everyone, those of you that are here. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless you. In these cold nights, we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that He protects us from the heat of Jahannam and the cold of Jahannam. Right? Sometimes when you get out, you realize, oh, it's cold. And if you have leather seats, then they're even colder. So you enjoy that. Most of the time, yes. Alhamdulillah. So, alhamdulillah, today we're going to be talking about a personality that I think I shouldn't be talking about, because somebody who knows about this personality more than me is Dr. Idris, because he's actually translating a lot of the works of the Sheikh, Muhaddis Shah Waliullah Dehlawi. So he's doing the translations from Farsi into Urdu. So obviously he's like a wealth of knowledge on his life and times and everything. Specifically, when you are going through translations of that person, you actually get to know more about it. I can't claim to know that because I don't read Farsi. There's a few things that are written in Arabic. A lot of his books have been translated into Arabic. But I just want us to, as I always do that, I always want us to go back a little bit and think about something. So what was happening in the world? So we talked about another reformist. Who remembers? We said that today, a lot of what we find in Islam in the subcontinent is thanks to this one person. Who was he? Yes. Barbarossa was last week. Yes. Sarhindi. Ahmed Sarhindi. So we talked about someone by the name of Ahmed Sarhindi. And we said that, you know, majority of what you see today as Islam practiced in the subcontinent, it was primarily due to the Reformation and the awareness of the more than awareness, but awareness and the right timing by Sheikh Ahmed Sarhindi at that time, who was also called Mujaddid Alf Thani, which was the reviver of the second Alf after Hijri, 900, 999, 1000. So Alf Thani Al Hijri, he is the Mujaddid of that. He revived the essence of Islam. So, in the subcontinent, there were three primary movements. Sorry, there were three primary reformers who religiously reformed the degeneration of Islamic faith, the mixing of the cultural values within Islam and thinking of it as Islamic practices, and a lot of dogmatic beliefs that people had passed down. And they would not want to do certain things related to, for example, Tafsir al-Quran. We'll talk about that. So one was definitely Sheikh Ahmed Sarhindi. He was from 1564 when he was born, and he died in 1624. Okay, 1564 he was born, and 1624 he passed away. Then, around 8 years later, another person came, and that person was known as Shah Waliullah Ad-Dehlawi. He was born in 1703, so almost 75 years plus 3, 75, like 80 years almost. So he comes in 1703 and he remains there till 1762. Now, when Sheikh Ahmed Sarhindi was born at that time, the Mughal Empire was at its peak. Alamgir, we talked about Fatawa Alamgiriya, he came later on. He ruled. After the death of Sheikh Ahmed Sarhindi, he ruled for 50 years. His rule extended all the way to the end of Bengal, Bangladesh today, and all the way on this east side, on the west side to Kabul. That was the range that he ruled, and that was all called Hind at that time. So he ruled for 50 years, and his fight, the last 25 years, he was up against a very strong uprising power at that time within Indian subcontinent, which is called either the Marathas or the Marhatas. They're pronounced both ways, the Marathas. Today, a lot of what you find, if you understand this history, you will be able to relate to a lot of what is happening in India today. So the RSS movement and all of the one who killed Gandhi, that guy from, the person who killed Gandhi, and that's Hindu sect. So the Maharashtra area in India is predominantly known as that zealous Hindu population that is very much, they believe that this whole continent, including Pakistan, now it's separated, but this entirety belongs to Hindus. And the Marathas were part, or Marhatas, they were part of that area, and that's how they came into rise. So Shah Waliullah Delhi, and then the third person was Sheikh Sayyid Ahmed Shaheed, who was 1786 to 1831. So these were the reformists. They laid the foundation for modern day Islamic movement within India and Pakistan. Well, Pakistan was not there, so India, and later on that became the freedom movement. Later on that became the movement through which the transformation of that movement led to the separation of Pakistan and the existence of Pakistan. Okay, so I'm giving you like hundreds of years in one sentence, right? So fill in the blanks, right? And their primary objective of the three, so if you were to say what unified the three reformists, what unified them? Or what was their one objective that all three, if you were to say, here are the three people, what was that one common denominator that they all called for? Which was return back to the Islamic principles. And it was really ironic to see that many of them, they belong to various different factions of sects that we find in Pakistan and India today. So for example, Sheikh Ahmed Sirhindi comes from the Naqshbandi Sufi tariqah, and he's like, listen, we need to stop this and we need to go back to Sunnah. Then comes Shah Waliullah Dehlvi, he comes from the Hanafi strong taqlidi, and he's like, we need to stop this and we need to go back to the hadith of Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. So you find that despite the fact that all of them belonged to various sects, predominant sects found today in Pakistan, they recognize, or India, they recognized the need to go back to the grassroots or early sources, because there was so much confusion and contortion in the messaging. Okay? And their thing was, go back to the Islamic rule and the principles. That's the one common denominator they all called for. Okay? Now, Shah Waliullah, his actual name was Qutbuddin, and he's also known as Imam al-Hindi. He's also known as Imam al-Hindi. Now, Shah Waliullah is, if you were to describe him as a personality, like throughout the history of Islam, there have been a lot of people that have come, because we are not going to have Anbiya after Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, huwa khatimun nabiyyin, he is the last one. But Allah is going to revive the ummah. And that revival is going to happen in every 100 years at the hands of someone. But then there's going to be these massive revivals. And if you were to say that from our history, who are the two abras, the two most prominent revivers of the sacred knowledge, then you can easily bring them down to two primary individuals, Ibn Taymiyyah and Imam Ghazali. Imam Ghazali, because of his defense against the philosophy and whatever work he did, Ibn Taymiyyah was also like a pinnacle of philosophy and logic, and then him bringing everybody back to the grassroots and the early sources. These were the two primary. Shah Waliullah Ad-Dehlawi, he was a mixture of the two. So he did the logical, the philosophical reform, as well as the grassroots and going back to the early sources reform. So if you were to say that, you could say that, you know, his personality, how would you describe it? It was leaning, half of it, very spiritual, lot of spirituality, lot of raqa'iq, lot of connecting to Allah and connecting our heart to Allah, and a lot of basics of going back to the fundamentals of our religion. Okay, so he memorized the entire Qur'an at the age of 17. Then he started at the madrasa that his father used to, Sheikh Shah Abdur Rahim, who used to teach, in a madrasa called Madrasa Ar-Rahimiyah. At the age of 17, he had already mastered Arabic language, Persian language, and as well as Urdu, primary language. At that time, Persian was the predominant language that everybody spoke, business was done in. Hindus would also use Persian as the primary mode of the language. As a matter of fact, you actually find many of the Persian Hindu poets who have poetry in Persian, but they're Hindus, because that was the primary language. You know, there used to be this saying they used to say, that in Urdu they would say, ke, something like, this person is studying Farsi, But you know, kismat ke khel, you know, padhe Farsi aur beche tel, ye kya kismat ke khel? That this person is studying Farsi, and look at the qadr, that despite the fact that English should have elevated him, Farsi should have elevated him, this guy still sells oil on the street. This is how qadr of Allah works. Right? So that's how they would sometimes refer to that, that if somebody knew Farsi, that was a thing at that time. So he mastered Farsi. Then not only that he mastered, at the age 17, he became an appointed teacher in the madrasa. Age 17. He was a teacher in the madrasa. But more importantly, he actually also learned other sciences such as geography and geography and math and other sciences. Then 2 years after his appointment, age 17, his father passed away. And then he carried on teaching in that madrasa for a good 12 years. After 12 years, he got an opportunity to go and visit Makkah for Hajj. And when he arrived in Makkah in Hajj, he decided to stay there for 8 years. And over there, he studied with numerous shuyukh at that time. And there are mixed accounts whether he got to meet Shaykh Abdul Wahhab, Imam Abdul Wahhab from the Najdi era. If you got to meet him or not, there's mixed accounts. Some say that they met, some say they didn't, because Imam Abdul Wahhab was also born right 2 years after him or 2 years earlier than him, and he lived 30 years longer than him. So there could have been a chance that they overlapped in those 8 years in Makkah, Allahu Alam. Nevertheless, he got some inspiration from him. Now, little bit of the circumstances where he came in, like his lifetimes. Like, how, remember how we talked about Sir Ahmad Sirhindi and what was taking place? So we're going to take you back in time so we can understand what was the circumstance that were happening during the time of Ahmad Sirhindi, during the time of Shah Waliullah Dehlvi. So number one, the Mughal government, the Mughal empire, it was towards the end. So they had become extremely weak. Now, after the passing of Aurangzeb, they had incompetent rulers that were coming into power. Babur, and you know, one upon the other, 2 years after that, somebody else 2 years after, and constant fight. So incompetence was at a very high level. So there were people who were getting rulership, but they were getting rulership because they were born into that family, but they really were not prepared to rule such a big country at that time. So what ended up happening is this Mughal empire started to break up. So the Punjabs, they separated, the Hyderabad and the Nizam of Hyderabad, they separated, the Bengal, they separated, and everybody started having their own little kingdoms. Then at that time, the king's khazain, the treasury, the Federal Reserve, you know, Bank of Canada, Bank of India at that time, was empty. There was no money left in it. So they basically used all of that. So financially, very difficult time for Muslims. And on top of that, they started implementing taxes on the people to fulfill that. So the poor man was getting poorer and the rich was getting richer. Very familiar to what takes place in today's world. So this was the circumstances. And on top of this, there were two powers that were rising, the Sikhs. On the upside, they were gaining a lot of power. And the Marhattas from the Maharashtra area in the center, they were gaining a lot of power. And they were doing a lot of these attacks. And unfortunately, a lot of the Muslims were aligning with the Marhattas. And they would be, you know, the Peshwa and these guys, they would, you know, Baji Rao and all of these, you know, famous movies that are made in Bollywood, Baji Rao and Panipat, the movie that is made, that's all made on his life. And incidents that took place in Shah Waliullah's life. Obviously, he didn't participate because he was a scholar. He never participated in any of these wars. But they took place during his lifetime. The Battle of the Third Battle of Panipat with Ahmad Shah Abdali, which there's an entire movie on it in Bollywood. So likewise, the movie Baji Rao or something, there's a movie on that. So that were all built on the same realm, where the Marhattas were rising and the Mughals were in the decline. So that takes place at that time. And what ends up happening is, this is so interesting to see, a man who is sitting in Delhi, he is visualizing all of this and he's saying, how can I bring about a grassroots change in the state of the Ummah in India at that time? And that's his ultimate concern. So he's not in any of the king's courts. He's not sitting with the royal people. He is in his hujra. He was a person that was known as a person that was very secluded. He would sit and do ibadah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala most of the time. But yet he was fully aware of what was taking place. So when he comes back from Mecca after studying there for 8 years, this becomes his concern. So he creates a plan. This plan is that I need to highlight the problem. So he, after a lot of discussions and all of that, he comes up and he highlights one primary problem. And this comes, which is that the lack of the Ummah's connection with Qur'an is the root cause of this problem right now. Now, let me give you a little bit of a backdrop of how Qur'an was treated at that time. So Qur'an was treated at that time, and unfortunately till today, in many of the madaris in India and Pakistan and Bangladesh, it is still treated like this, what I'm going to describe, which is tafsir is a matter of experts. That knowledge has been passed down by, you know, it was the knowledge that was passed down from one chest to another. It is not accessible to the awam. Awam is not supposed to pick up the translation of the Qur'an. We are not supposed to pick up the tafsir of the Qur'an. We're supposed to look at the Qur'an, venerate it, feel reverence for it in the bookshelves, and, you know, touch it, kiss it. But, you know, it's something very sacred. We should not get close to this. And, you know, chui muika poda, like, you know, just like don't touch it. It's like, there's something, you know, there's a saying, it's like, you know, a plant that is very weak and delicate. Don't touch Qur'an. So this was the state at that time. And he recognized that what was happening was the people who were the custodians of the Qur'an, you know, pardon to say my language, but like custodians who were responsible for spreading the message of the Qur'an, he entered in one of the majlis, and guess what they were discussing? They were having discussions on what was the nature of the fruit that Adam alayhi salam ate. Okay, so this is how far we had gone. That we had forgotten the whole purpose of the story of Adam alayhi salam, and the story that insan, when we make a mistake, we do tawbah, and the lesson that we learn from that story. Rather, the details were in what exactly happened, what type of the fruit, was it a date, was it an apple, what is it this and that, and then what was the sifa of, that was the discussion that was taking place. Completely irrelevant to the amal of an average day person. So, then he initiated a movement that today we all are benefiting from. Today this center and other centers like it that focus on spreading the message of the Qur'an are a byproduct of that movement, which is that we are to not rely too much on phrasal translations of the Qur'an, because in that you can include your own interpretations. Rather, we are to go back and look at the text of the Qur'an and each word of the text of the Qur'an, and then when we read the phrasal translation, being able to decipher whether somebody is misleading us or whether they are giving us the true translation. So he initiated that word-to-word translation. At that time, translations were considered very, very like, oh, you're doing a translation of the Qur'an? Qur'an is not supposed to be translated. Qur'an is supposed to be understood in Arabic. I'll give you a true example, like how bad this is today. I met somebody told me that there's this famous sheikh who is from India. He is a master of Arabic language. He is an expert of this and so on, like so many qualities that were mentioned about his grasp on the Arabic language. So obviously, finally, I got a chance, I got a number, and I reached out to him. And this was during my stay in the Middle East. He was there for some work, and he was there for 2 years on a visa, on a contract. And I said, Sheikh, I would like to study from you. So the sheikh, he said, what have you studied in Arabic? So I told him, you know, not really like that much, but like, you know, just basic ajrumiya, mutammim al-ajrumiya, and qatrun nada. And then I'm studying with this sheikh, and I'm doing tafsir of Jalalain with him. So imagine the impact of that Quran should only be learned a specific way, and you must spend 8 years mastering Arabic before you can even open the Quran. That mentality was still found today, where the sheikh told me, that is very strange. I pray to Allah that you may not understand anything from your sheikh. Can you imagine? And I'm sitting in front of the sheikh, and another friend of mine who's also a Canadian, he happens to be a professor of Quran today at a university. We were sitting there, and we both looked at each other, and we're like, what did he just say? He said, لَعَلَّكَ تَقْرَى وَلَا تَفْهَمْ شَيْءٍ. Inshallah. Ajeeb. Ajeeb. This is how far they went from Qur'an. And the impacts of that is still there today. I still remember moments, a time where, you know, few converts, they came back from Canada, converts from Canada, went to study somewhere in a madrasa in Karachi. They came back and then they found these translations of the Qur'an and they got so zealous, they wanted to get rid of the translations of the Qur'an in the local masjid that I was there. They're like, this is haram, we can't have translations of the Qur'an. Qur'an is only supposed to be read in Arabic. And you have to master Arabic in 8 years and only then you can read translations. Okay? So this was all that, you know, that sentiment, he came, Shah Waliullah, to come and break that. So he said, I'm going to do the word to word. He was not able to do that. His son completed it. He did the first translation in Farsi. Why Farsi? Because Farsi was the elite language. So he's like, if I can influence the elite, then the influence will trickle down. So he did the translation of the first translation of the Quran in Farsi. As a matter of fact, he also did, according to Shah Waliullah, the most valuable book of hadith is Muwatta Imam Malik. He believes that Muwatta Imam Malik is the first book of hadith because it was technically the first book of hadith that was written. So that is the, so in his category, Shah Waliullah, he puts Muwatta Imam Malik, the book of Imam Malik, as number one hadith book, and then all other books follow after. So he did the translate, he did the sharh of that, one sharh in Arabic and another one in Farsi. That Farsi one is what Dr. Idris is, I believe, translating into Urdu. Then that's one element. So that was his first plan, that I'm going to make Quranic accessibility for everyone. Nobody will have an excuse not to be able to understand the Quran. The second thing he did is he began a movement which was very ambitious, which was educating, organizing, and awakening Muslims. So he started creating smaller packages of these doses, kind of like antibiotics. And he would go into a small madrasa or a small masjid, and those packages were given in those high doses to different masajids so he can start bringing about the change. Kind of like what took place during the time of Saifuddin al-Qutuz, the first story that we did, Wild Beast, where at that time, Izz ibn Abdus Salam, he gathered over 300 khutaba off the world. He sent letters to the primary 300 masjids, brought them all together, made them memorize Surah Anfal and Surah Tawbah, and said for the next 6 months, no khutbah will be given except it will be either from Tawbah or Anfal. And then the ummah, after 6 months, was ready to follow somebody like Saifuddin al-Qutuz to defend Quds, to defend Palestine, Bayt al-Maqdis. So similar to what he did. So he created these smaller packages to boost, to awaken, and to organize the ummah around him. Then he did another thing, which was that the Marhatas, they were taking away lands of the Muslim. So he wanted to create this awakening that we as Muslims cannot give our lands away to non-Muslims in terms of the fight. It was always a fight of who rules Hindustan, right? Who rules that entire subcontinent. So this fight, he started calling the defense movement and defending it against the Marhatas and the Sikhs on the top. And those were the three primary things that his plan included. Now, some of the services that he provided to us. Number one, I already mentioned the translation of the Quran in Persian. Number two, he had written lots of books. So for example, he wrote a book which was, in translation of it, it's called The Source of Ikhtilaf. Why do we have differences? So in that, he explained to the awam. Today you hear this all the time. He's like, oh, Muslims are so disunited, you know, they can't pray, you know, one guy prays differently, another guy prays differently. Why is there so much differences? Those are the same questions people were asking at that time. So he wrote a book to dispel this and to explain to them that the source code is the same. It's how you understand that source code differs. And I'll give you an example of that. This is for maybe the older people, maybe the kids won't get this example, but you know, for us. So there, you know, how many times do you have to do masa over your socks? One time or three times? How many times do you do masah over your socks? To wipe over your socks. One time, right? One time. So there's a madhab. They will say, no, you do three times. There's another opinion that says you must do three times. Now, both of them do not have any clear-cut evidences of one or three. So one of them, they said, look, this is a masa, like we're doing masa over socks. And the act of masa, the only other hadith we have is we do masa over our heads and we do it one time. So since we do it one time, we will also do it one time here. Okay? So they do masa one time on the socks. The others, they came and they said, no. No, that's not true. So the closest thing to our head, the closest thing from the wajibat, the closest thing is our face. And we wash our face three times. So we must, that's the closest wajib to the foot, so we must do the masa three times because that's the closest thing. They're using the qiyas, it's all qiyas, but how they look at that angle differs. So those differences are sometimes rahmah, because we're looking at it. Similarly, the example of salat ul-jama'ah being wajib, obligatory. The Hanabila, they hold the opinion, and the Ahl al-Hadith, they hold the opinion it's wajib, it's mandatory. There's enough hadith about that. And the primary hadith they use in that is what the hadith of Prophet ﷺ, where he says, if I willed, I would have appointed somebody to pray, and then do what? Go and burn the house of the individual who is not praying. Right? So who's not praying in jama'ah. That hadith, a group of people used and said, no, this is a hadith that proves to us it's wajib. The other groups, they came and they said, no, wait a minute, that hadith proves that it's not wajib. How? Because, what? No, because he said, I would leave. And Rasulullah will never leave a wajib. If it was a wajib, why would he appoint somebody else? So they used that same hadith and they said, no, wait a minute. That is a hadith that tells you it's a highly important act, but it's not wajib because Rasulullah is saying, I would leave. So its salah is being established and he's saying, I'll walk away from it. It's a double negative. Exactly. Right? So there's sources. So he gave all of such examples to make people aware that there is no ikhtilaf between Muslims. We are more united than we believe. Those superficial differences are rather the same hadith that we understand. The second thing he did is he wanted to replace all the incompetent rulers. So one of the, and I'm not going to go into this, Ahmad Shah Abdali and the entire battle that take place. It is called the Battle of Panipat, the third battle of Panipat. There is a very nice documentary in English. It's on, let me just, it, the YouTube channel is called Kings and Generals. Kings and Generals. There's a YouTube channel called Kings and Generals. On that, there's a Battle of Panipat 1761. It's a 24-minute documentary with visuals and stuff for the kids. You know, a lot of the adults would enjoy. You would need to explain a few things that are happening, but it's in English. So you can actually watch the entire battle. And this explanation of the visuals of where the camp of the Muslims were, how were they positioned, what was the position of their camps, beautifully visualized with graphics, and then the battalion one moved forward, and you actually are visualizing as he is explaining the battle, beautifully done. So I don't think I can even top that. And good thing is it's in English, so all of you guys can watch. If it was in Arabic, then I would have to translate, or some of us could understand Arabic. So he said, I'm going to replace those rulers. So what he did is on the southern side, he brought somebody by the name of, have you heard of Nawab Sirajuddola? Right, he brought somebody, and there was a battle of Palsli in 1757. This is towards the end of the Sheikh's life. And they used the inspiration and the source code written by Ahmad Shah Waliullah Ad-Dhilwi. They used that source code for the battle, although the Muslims lost that battle, but it was a good thing. While this battle was taking place, there's a secondary thing that happened, which is the 1761 Battle of Panipat, where Ahmad Shah Abdali, the last 20 years, he has been conquering Persia. And now he has Persia and he has entered Sindh and Punjab, and he is entering from the top. He's all the way to Delhi. So the Mughal emperors, the remaining emperors, they say, listen, we are desperately in need of an ally. Why don't you come in? He had already invaded India three times before. the Marhatas were extremely, like when they hear his name, they're like, whoa, Shah Abdali is coming. They were really scared of him, right? So he agrees to defend the Muslims. And then the entire battle was a very interesting battle, beautifully explained. Even when I watched the whole video, other than a few points where he sides with the Hindus in that, because I don't know what, maybe he has some historical sources he's using, most of it was very objective. Most of it was very objective, and it talks about the true fall of how Marathas fell. It's something really good to watch, so I'm not going to delve into that. You guys can have a separate session with the family, and you know it'll be a good thing. Now, some of the services in economic services. So he was not just a religious reformer. He also realized that real reform cannot take place if I don't put it in some sort of source code for people to follow in terms of economic. So he actually wrote a book, and he categorized professions. So he said these are the A-grade professions that are necessary for Muslim Ummah to have. There should be at least 5% of the or 10% of the population must fall under these professions. The rest of the, and then he enlisted those professions and the impact of those professions on the society. So he was working as a sociologist. And you know, and they mentioned that, you know, some of the sociologists of Pakistan and stuff, people that have like a lot of PhDs, they mentioned that he was a very big social thinker. So his thought, so for example, he says he had the thought way before economic equilibrium became a theory in today's world. Like if you go into social studies and you learn about economic equilibrium, he presented that theory based on Quran and Sunnah back in, you know, 1700s. So think about that. There's this theory of economic equilibrium. Bottom line, the way this means is wealth is equally distributed. So the rich never become richer and the poor never become poorer. Rather, there is a standard of equilibrium that the government maintains. And if that is maintained, and if there is certain people that rise, no problem. But as long as there is massive offset where 10% of the population is super rich and the rest are poor, then we have to adopt an economic equilibrium theory of distributing the wealth equally. Right, and that's a theory that he did. Another thing he really worked on was removal of inequalities. Equalities of caste. This caste is higher than this caste, which we learned from the Hindus. And removal of all other forms of inequality. So for example, languages. So one of the falls of the Mughal, if you think about it, what happened was when Aurangzeb passed, Alamgir passed away, people within those camps, they started, says, oh, you're a Sindhi. You're a Punjabi, you speak Sindhi, you speak Flana, you speak, and they started looking, and you know, looking at others based on what? Based on national, we're more alike, you eat the same food and stuff. No, but you're different than me. I am different than you. You are more darker, I am more lighter, you are more fairer, I have this. So these inequalities that became part of that society, they removed. Then the next thing he did is he brought a financial system which was not based on interest. For the first time, a documented financial system that a country can be built on, which was not based on interest. And the third thing he said is zakat. He created an institutionalized framework for zakat to be implemented. And if many of the Muslim countries today just take that framework, a lot of the poverty in those countries is going to be completely gone. Like there are certain Muslim countries, I'm not going to name them, certain Muslim countries, if you have wealth staying in your bank for a certain amount of time, the government is going to come and take 2.5% without your permission, right? So what people do right before the hawl, right before the thing is there, they take out all the money. And the government has no way of, that government has no way of knowing that money was, so they either take out the money or they move it into a different bank account. Right? So he created a system. Again, I'm not going into those systems because that's not the point of these lectures. So you can further read about him. Now, in the end, the social services that he provided, this is something really interesting, right? These were the economic services. Social. So he emphasized on, way before the social justice movement that's taking us by storm today, that everybody should have equal rights, he emphasized that all basic rights to live, right? Such as fair justice to every person, such as brotherhood, al-ukhuwa within the Muslims, must be the predominant characteristics of the Muslim society. And anybody that tries to break that social fabric should be taken to account right away. Because that is how we're built as a society. MashaAllah. Then he says, last one, he's the first of the scholars in Hind who openly wrote books against the practice of Hinduism, which was jahiz, dowries. He wrote against that this is not a practice of Muslims. Unfortunately, till today, many of the, even the Muslims are participating in this, right? Many, like, and even in Canada, like, I do nikahs, and when I do nikahs, and they're like, yes, and then they have to find certain things. When I sit down with the families, and I was like, you know, so did you guys agree on mahar? And literally, I've had people, the father of the guy's like, no, aren't they supposed to pay the mahar? I'm like, no. Your son is getting married. He has to pay mahar to her. Oh, that's so strange. I thought they were supposed to pay his mahar. This has happened, and I'm about to do the nikah, and they haven't even talked about this. The assumption is the girl's side is going to pay mahar. And this is in Canada, right? So he wrote heavily against this particular ideology that this needs to end. And this mahar is, and then again, as a practice, I always tell people your mahar, especially the younger people getting married here, I always tell them you should have three bank accounts. One is your personal bank account, husband and wife, each one of them. One have your joint bank account. And the mahar should always go to the personal account of the girl, not the joint account. This is how we as Muslims can avoid a lot of these divorces that are taking place. And then, by the way, the gifts that you get in your wedding, that should be all put in a joint account. Guys, girls, whatever, both sides. And then a discussion on how you want to use that. Because 90% of the time when they come for a divorce, it's something to do with these two things. He took that, we put it in the joint account, he gave me $5,000 mahar, he used up to buy a car. Well, why did you put it in the joint account in the first place? It was yours. So the first goes, yeah, he did something wrong, but why did you, as somebody growing up in Canada, put it in that, like, you know, so that's, I don't know why I sidetracked on that, anyhow, whatever, because I see those problems, so, anyhow. In conclusion, what Shah Waliullah Dehlvi, he did, was basically, he laid the foundation that today you and I see, as I was telling one of the brothers that was here, that what we find today, related to the movement of Qur'an, the amount of Hufaz that are coming out of Pakistan and India and Bangladesh, and the connection and the word to word, all of these movements, the varying forms of movements that are taking place, all of them, if you were to say, where is Ra'sul Naba, where is the source of that river, then you can all trace it back to the first translation of the Quran in Farsi, and then later on in Urdu, and then his sons, they completed the translation of Urdu. As a matter of fact, many of the modern day the writers like Imam al-Hindi, the one from the 1900s, not this one, the next one, in 1906, when he wrote the tarjuma of the Quran, he said, I did not do anything or any changes except I changed the idiomatic expressions. So there was a lot of influence on Farsi and Urdu from Hindi in the 1800s when that translation was written. So that was cleansed. So people might, you know, confuse, or there were a lot of words that were used in Urdu that were influenced and brought in by Hindi, which were not longer used. And that also tells us that translations should not be left to, like, you know, Muhammad Pictol is a great translation. None of the kids are ever going to understand that translation. Right? Like, you pick it up and try to read it, you're not going to get it. He did a great job for his time. And that is why today, one of the best translations you can find in English is written by a very good friend of ours who happens to have a masjid very close to us over here, Dr. Mustafa Khattab, all the clear Quran. One of the easiest translations for a modern, any, like, 10, 12-year-old kid can pick it up and understand it. Beautifully written, well done, nice footnotes, the clear Quran, in my opinion. I've seen others. It is very relevant to the Canadian context, in the Western context, and how he has written it in terms of the idiomatic expressions that he has used in English. Inshallah. They have a kid's version too, yes. Yeah. Inshallah. With that, and then what happens is, you know, his obviously towards the end of his life, he passes away, rahimahullah. His death, as we mentioned, he passes away in 1762. And then, inshallah, if we get a chance and life, then we'll do some other stories. If you have any questions about this, please feel free to ask. I have a question. So what do we learn from his life? Like, I have three lessons in front of me, but I want to know, what did you guys learn? What's this? Okay, great story, amazing, mashallah, great job. Good job, Sheikh. What did you, like, you know, good job, Sheikh Shah Waliullah, great. You revived the Ummah. Okay, what do we learn from it? Beautiful. Don't think that you're alone. Don't ever think that you can't bring the change. Don't ever think, you know, you got to put in that effort. The result is in the hands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You be sincere to your task. You do the best you can. You give it the effort you can. You leave the rest. As Muslims, when you know what it means, and this is something the kids can understand and you'll be able to take away from this. When you go to your school, when you're about to write your exam, you say, Bismillah. What does that mean? Like, we all say, in the name of Allah. What is that? Why in the name of Allah? What does that indicate? Yeah. Okay, what you're saying is, in the name of Allah, i.e. I am starting this exam, O Allah, I have done my effort, now I am fully relying on you for the results of this. So I begin with your name, and I know that you are there with me, I have done my effort. Don't say Bismillah and you have not prepared for the exam, that's a different story, right? Then Allah is not going to come for your help, right? Like, you prepared, you worked hard, and then you come and you write the exam and you say Bismillah. That I start this journey with Allah, hoping that Allah is going to have a great result out of this, inshallah. Okay? What else? That was a good lesson. Yes? Beautiful. Sources, right? Going back to the sources and understanding the sources. Now, one thing very important for us to also understand is that, like, sources, when we go back to the original sources, they are great for our inspiration, not for you and me to start driving rulings out of it. So when you read that story or in hadith, like, you know, I teach like Friday morning Shama'il, right? So when I'm teaching Shama'il, it's great to know that Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam had a khatim. It's great to know that his ring was made out of Abyssinian silver mixed with another type of silver and those tafasil. That's great to know, right? Now, what did he do with this ring and all of that? But if there is something related to, for example, the hukum of wearing the ring and having Allah's name and going to the bathroom, right? We cannot say, oh, by the way, I read one hadith about it, so it must be haram, right? Like, because we don't have all other ahadith related to that, so that is left to the scholars. Like, even till today, when somebody asks me a fiqh question, I tell them, I'm not a faqih, go and ask somebody else, right? I have not specialized in fiqh. And this is a responsibility in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If you say something is haram, you must really know 110% and you have access to all the sources to come to this conclusion that this is halal or haram. So I remember somebody saying this, oh, you're not allowed to read Muhammad. If it's Muhammad written on your shirt, you can't do that. It's haram, right? Obvious haram. But then when you read about it, it's actually, no. When, like, for example, if you're wearing a basketball shirt and it says your name on it, right, what are you going to do? You take off your shirt and go to the bathroom now? Right, that Muhammad is pointing to who? It's pointing to you, the one who's wearing the shirt. Right? So the ulama, they said, in that circumstance, you're okay to use that shirt. But if you are wearing that sign, Muhammad, denoting Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, then that, in that case, it becomes prohibited for you to wear something like that. Right? So going back to the sources for inspiration, definitely. Connecting ourselves back to the Qur'an. Right? Connecting ourselves back to the message of the Qur'an. Very essential. All the reforms that take place can only take place if we hold on to the Qur'an. If we hold on to the Qur'an. Remember the hadith, and I'll end with this because I don't want the food to get cold. Right. Yes. So I'll end with this hadith where Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, there's a person that came to Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and he saw a dream. And he said, I saw a dream and I saw that there's a cloud, and from this cloud there is ghee and honey, saman and asal, that is raining down. And there are people who are taking their clots and they're like trying to get فَمِنْهُمْ الْمُسْتَكْثِرُ. Some people have taken a lot of honey and saman and ghee, and some are qaleel. Ya Rasulullah, tell me the meaning of this. What do you think is the meaning of this? Let's see if you guys can guess. What does that mean? A cloud that is raining down ghee and honey. Parathe. If you're Desi, you're going to be like fatair. You know, fatira, parathe. That's the only possible, you know, it's like the only thing remaining, Ya Rasulullah, is a parathe. Like, you know, I need to add it, like, you know, right? Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu was sitting and he's like, Ya Rasulullah, I am going to interpret this. You have to allow me. So Rasulullah is like, go ahead and do it. Give it. He says, as for the canopy, as for the cloud, that is the Qur'an. And as for the ghee and the honey, it's the sweetness of the Qur'an and the slayin, the softness of the Qur'an. And as for those who are gathering, then those are people from that sweetness and softness. There are those that drink a lot, take a lot, and there are those that drink less. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that He enriches our hearts with the sweetness and the softness of the Quran, inshaAllah.